Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Revolution Church. We are excited to be here on another Sunday, and I'm excited to worship alongside of my sister in Christ, Carolina Soto. Welcome, and thank you for being here today. And we are just excited to just to give God glory and honor and praise this morning. And so right where you are, virtually, if you're watching from home or later from today, we just welcome you. And we ask, if you are in the chat, just welcome your virtual neighbor right now. Say hello, good morning, praise the Lord. Let's just give God glory this morning because he is worthy of the praise. And let's go to God in prayer. Father God, thank you for this day. You are truly an amazing God, and we worship and adore you, God. We thank you for the gift of life, the gift of breath, God, the ability to just lift up our voices to you, God. And so we ask that you would just enter into this worship experience, God, and just be very present, God, with us today through this worship and through this time of word, God. We love you and we thank you. We ask these things in Christ's name. Amen. Amen. How many of you know that we serve an unstoppable God? Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Come on, let's worship him.
God, let your glory go on and on.
like, hallelujah. You're so great.
Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ, Lord, we just thank you for this opportunity to worship you, to declare your goodness, O Lord God, to come together, Lord, using technology to sing unto you, to think on how awesome you are. We pray that you will use this time mightily for your glory, that we would learn something powerful that we can apply to our lives. May our lives be forever changed as a result of what we learned today. In Jesus Christ's name, amen. Amen. Good morning, everybody. Good morning. It's so good to see you all in the chat. My name is Devin Turner. I'm blessed to be the pastor of the amazing Revolution Church. And today we have a message that has an awesome looking crown on it. you all take a look at the screen, our title is Understanding His Majesty. And we're going to talk about that today because I think we need to be reminded of who is the ultimate authority in our lives. As we are in this political climate here in this country and around the world, we need to understand God's majesty more and more. And so our focus point for this morning, if you don't remember anything else that we talk about, is this. God's plan is to use foolish people like me to help the intelligent and the ignorant understand His majesty. Now, some of us may have a problem with this kind of focus point because the focus point is calling us foolish. I need you to understand something really quickly. When the Bible tells us that we are foolish people, and I'm going to show you where the Bible says that in a little bit, it is a level of humility that we must embrace, that God is all-knowing and all-powerful and that we are not. All of us have made foolish decisions and made poor choices in our lives, but God does not look for perfect people, which is such a blessing because none of us qualify. But God uses everyday, ordinary people like you and like me to help people that are intelligent and ignorant understand His majesty. Let's take a look at a definition on the screen for the word majesty. The word majesty simply means royalty. It means supreme greatness and authority. And when it comes to our lives, there is none more powerful. There is none more greater. There is none more worthy of admiration and to be the supreme greatness in our lives than the one true God of the Bible, Yahweh, and His Son, Yeshua, who we call Jesus Christ. Now, if you take a look at your Bibles really quickly, we're going to turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 18. Now, you may be saying, Pastor Devin, why do I need to listen to what God has to say about this whole majesty thing and this whole crown stuff? And here's why. We need to understand what God has to say about this today, because if we don't, we may misplace the authority that belongs to God to someone else or something else, and we may miss our opportunity to help people understand His majesty. And so God doesn't want you and I to be out of the loop. He doesn't want us to be left off on the wayside. He wants us to be right in tune with His plan to help people understand His majesty. And it's so important, whether they're intelligent or ignorant, because it doesn't matter if people are blind to the fact of God's power, are unaware of God's existence, or if they're super intelligent, have many degrees, or been in the church all their lives. God wants to use everybody on that spectrum, from people who don't know much to people who know a lot, to help the world see His majesty. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 18. The Bible says this, "The message of the cross is foolish to those who are headed for destruction. But we who are being saved know it is the very power of God. As the scriptures say, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and discard the intelligence of the intelligent." That's interesting. Let's take a look at that. God says here in verse 19, "I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and discard the intelligence of the intelligent." In other words, there are people that think they know something and they're walking in their own arrogance and pride. And God will reveal to them how little they know because they're seeking knowledge apart from Him who is all knowledgeable and all powerful. We look at verse 18. The Bible says that the message of the cross is foolish. What's the message of the cross? The message of the cross is that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, loves the whole world so much that He died on a cross for everybody's sins. And whoever puts their hope and trust in Him will not perish but have everlasting life. It's a stupid fairy tale, man. What are you doing? This ain't nursery rhyme hour. Well, it seems idiotic and dumb to people who don't understand God's power, for people who are headed for destruction. And if we can be honest, some of us have found ourselves heading to destruction before we came to know the Lord. And some of us who are with us right here on the screen right now, we don't know the Lord. Some of you may not know the Lord as your personal Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. And the Bible says that you're headed for destruction because you think that you know what life is all about. So you've been going about life your own way, but your own way is the wrong way because Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life, and that no person can come to the Heavenly Father but through Him." You got to take the crossroad to get to that destination, and the crossroad is found through Jesus Christ. Let's get back to the text. When we jump back in the scriptures, verse 20, the Bible says, "So where does this leave the philosophers, the scholars, and the world's brilliant debaters? God has made the wisdom of this world look foolish. Since God in his wisdom saw to it that the world would never know him through human wisdom, he has used our foolish preaching to save those who believe. Let's stop right there. The word preaching simply means to proclaim, to herald, to announce, okay? I've used this illustration before when I've defined the word preaching. I'll do it again. I remember watching Disney cartoons back in the day, and I believe it was Aladdin when I was younger, and there was a herald, H-E-R-A-L-D. I had to think about how to spell that. And the herald's job was basically to go before the Supreme Majesty, to go before the king, and to declare, the king approaches, right? You remember those cartoons where it's like a little person that has a little horn and walks with all this authority and just basically announces what's about to be obvious. Well, that's what preaching is. And God's not picking some special people to do that. He's choosing everyday people like you and like me to state what's about to be obvious. And I want you to let that sink in for a moment. Because it's not obvious to the world right now that God exists. Some people don't believe God exists. It's not obvious to the many people in the world that Jesus Christ is the one true, most powerful God. No. There's all types of theologies, all types of faiths and belief systems out there. There's all types of ways that people are thinking up of how to get to heaven or to have paradise after you die on this earth. And the Bible is telling you and I that these brilliant people who have all these philosophies, they look at us like we're foolish. Look at this here in verse 20. God has made the wisdom of this world look foolish. Since God in his wisdom saw to it that the world would never know him through human wisdom, he has used our foolish preaching to save those who believe. Why is God calling it foolish preaching? Because it doesn't make sense that a guy like me would be pastoring a church talking to some awesome people like you through technology on a screen that's being streamed live. Why doesn't that make sense? Because I didn't go to Bible college. I didn't have a theological degree. I don't wear church clothes. As somebody said that to me last Sunday when we had our social distance service, which was awesome, by the way. Somebody said, hey, he's not wearing pastor clothes. One of our members was FaceTiming our worship experience out on the field, our social distance service, and she was FaceTiming her brother, and during praise and worship, I leaned over and just kind of waved at him on the FaceTime, and he was like, who's that? And she said, that's my pastor. He said, he don't got preacher clothes on. I was like, well, what are preacher clothes? So sometimes God will use ordinary people that don't have the attire that fits the mold, don't have the education that fits the mold, and sometimes God will use people like me and you that don't seem to measure up, that don't seem to qualify, that may not have the intellect as other people, that may not have the degrees as other people, but God would use foolish people like us to proclaim his awesome power to those who will believe. And I want you to understand that you're a part of that plan. Let's look at that focus point one more time. If you don't remember anything else that we talk about this morning, I want you to remember this. God's plan is to use foolish people like me to help the intelligent and the ignorant understand his majesty. God's plan is to use foolish people like me to help the intelligent and the ignorant understand his majesty. Now, the word ignorant basically means to not be aware of, to not have the information, to be missing the knowledge about a certain subject or person, place, or thing. There are people that are missing the knowledge of God, and God wants to use us. Although they look at us like we're foolish, although they're going to say, man, girl, what you talking about? You over here talking about God. I don't want to hear all that. Bro, what you mean, man? What you mean there's only one God, man? This all this stuff right here. What you mean this is sin? How is that a sin and this ain't a sin? It's foolish to people who are headed for destruction. We read that in verse 18 a few moments ago. But God wants to use us because we look like the people we're talking to. We came from some of the lifestyles that some of the people we're talking to have. And if we have the love of God in our hearts and we have the word of God in our mouths, we can preach, proclaim, declare what is about to be obvious. Pastor Devin, why do you keep saying what's about to be obvious? Here's why. Because some people are not aware that our God is the one true God. But the book of Revelation tells us very clearly that the whole world will know at the end of the earth, at the end of time. The Bible tells us that every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Our job is to proclaim His majesty and help as many of our family members, friends, co-workers, neighbors understand His majesty before they leave this earth. That they would receive the message of the cross, that they would receive the gospel truth, that they would live for His majesty and be a part of His plan to be used, a foolish person like us, for His majesty. One more time, our focus point for this morning, if you don't remember anything else. God's plan is to use foolish people like me to help the intelligent and the ignorant understand His majesty. Let's get back to the passage. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. We're going to jump down now to verse 22. Let's look at verse 22 together. The Bible says it is foolish. There's that word again. It is foolish to the Jews who ask for signs from heaven. And it is foolish to the Greeks who seek human wisdom. So when we preach that Christ was crucified, the Jews are offended and the Gentiles say it's all nonsense. Verse 24. But to those called by God to salvation, both Jews and Gentiles, Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God. This foolish plan of God is wiser than the wisest of human plans, and God's weakness is stronger than the greatest of human strength. Let's stop right there. Pastor Devin, why would God choose to keep using the word foolish over and over and over again, saying the plan is foolish, His plan is foolish, He's using foolish people like us, the world is going to perceive us as foolish? Why would God want to use us, a part of a foolish plan, to declare His majesty? The reason why God does that, y'all, is so that nobody can take credit for it when it's successful. Have you ever been in a situation where everything that could go wrong did go wrong? People that you thought you could depend on or rely on left you hanging, and you had nowhere else to look but up. And it was in that moment of weakness, that moment of brokenness, that moment of you maybe feeling like you were doing something weird and idiotic, where you lifted your hands or you turned your heart toward God, you prayed to God, somehow you made it through that situation. God does that at times to remind us and to reveal to us how awesome and powerful He is so that He gets all the glory. Can you imagine if God only chose people to declare the gospel of Jesus Christ that were people that had a bunch of degrees, a bunch of money, high intellect, dressed the best, and all that kind of stuff? How would people be walking around here sharing the gospel? Oh, I'm so saved and you're not. You're going to hell. Like, it would be the most arrogant people walking around so pompous, so proud, chest out, talking like this, but I'm from Northeast DC. Like, just carrying themselves like they eat Grey Poupon all the time. And the thing is that God will use hood people like us, normal people like us, people that didn't finish school, people that don't have the greatest jobs, but our faith is in the right place. And God will say, that's my girl, that's my guy. And He will use people like me and you for His plan that the world will say is foolish. Let me tell you something. I had a pastor, a so-called pastor, who told me I would not be successful at being a pastor. He hated on the whole idea of me coming to DC and planning Revolution Church. He told me I would never, ever be successful. Well, brother, the church is 6.5 years old, just about, and we have seen hundreds of people come to faith in Jesus Christ. We have helped hundreds of families here in the city and abroad, and we are continuing to do God's work. Now, he looked at me and said, Sterling Devin Turner? Being a pastor? The way he acts? The way he talks? What congregation is going to want to listen to him? The way he dresses? Psh, that's foolish. And God said, that's my guy. And I'm telling you, there's nothing special about me. If God will use a foolish person like Sterling Devon Turner, God can surely use you. Our focus point, if you don't remember anything else, is this. God's plan is to use foolish people like me. Somebody just put in the chat, like me. Just put in the chat, like me. God's plan is to use foolish people like me to help the intelligent and the ignorant understand His Majesty. Let's keep going back to the text. Verse 26. Remember, dear brothers and sisters, that few of you were wise in the world's eyes, or powerful, or wealthy when God called you. Instead, God chose things the world considers, here it is, foolish, in order to shame those who think they are wise. And He chose things that are powerless to shame those who are powerful. God chose things despised by the world, things counted as nothing at all, and used them to bring to nothing what the world considers important. Who am I preaching to this morning? Who am I talking to in the chat this morning? People told you was nothing. You were weak. You were powerless. You ain't got it. You ain't man enough. You ain't woman enough. You ain't got what it takes. That's foolish. You're powerless. You ain't wise enough. You ain't smart enough. You can never do that. Who am I talking to in the chat? I see you. I see you. God loves to use people like you and me that the world has counted out, so that when God does something with us, the world will say, dang, there has to be some higher power, because for God to use her, for Him to make it like that. And then when you make it, right? Oh, thank you, Lord. This is why God also uses foolish people like us. Ready? Because we humble enough to know we ain't get here by ourselves. We're recording in my living room right now with lights and cameras and this screen here. I got a wife and two kids, great family. How did I get here? The dude that was helping my older brother sell drugs in high school. The dude that had a gun to my face. The dude that tried to hang himself twice. That guy who used to be volatile and angry and cantankerous and try to jump in fights. God chose to use Sterling Devon Turner. See, God uses foolish people like us because we realize that it has to be a divine, powerful God that will do something radical inside of us that can make us be anything other than wicked, other than horrible, other than vile, other than corrupt, other than cantankerous. The fact that I am a pastor is proof that God exists. If you knew my past and where I've been and what I've experienced and what's in my family tree, it's the power of the divine God. See, people that think they got it all together, when they so-called make it, they arrogantly say, I pulled myself up by my own bootstraps. But people like me, I know it was the blood. I know it was the blood. I know we don't sing that song in Revolution too much, but I know it was the blood of the one true God that saved me, a wretch like me. One day when I was lost, Jesus died on the cross, and I know it was the blood for a fool like me. Focus point. If you don't remember anything else we talk about this morning, don't forget this. This is something you need to tweet. God's plan is to use foolish people like me to help the intelligent, the smart people, and the ignorant, the not so smart people, understand His Majesty. Let's get back to the scripture. This verse encouraged me so much, y'all. Let's look at verse 27 again. Let's go to 26. I'm feeling it this morning. Remember, dear brothers and sisters, that few of you were wise in the world's eyes, or powerful, or wealthy when God called you. In other words, you was weak and broke, and you wasn't that smart, according to the world standards. Verse 27, instead, God chose things the world considers foolish in order to shame those who think they are wise. And he chose things that are powerless to shame those who are powerful. God chose things despised by the world, things counted as nothing at all, and used them to bring to nothing what the world considers important. Look at 29. As a result, no one can ever boast in the presence of God. God has united you with Christ Jesus. For our benefit, God made him to be wisdom itself. Christ made us right with God. He made us pure and holy, and he freed us from sin. Thank you, Jesus. Last verse for today. Therefore, as the scriptures say, if you want to boast, boast only about the Lord. Man, there's so much in that passage. Let's jump back really quickly. Verse 28, God chose things despised by the world, things counted as nothing at all, and used them to bring to nothing what the world considers important. There's so much in this text. Man, that's loaded. Got to break it down. Look at verse 28. Y'all look here with me, right here on the screen. God chose things despised by the world. People like you and me. People hated on, despised, hated on, rejected. You ain't this, you ain't that, you ain't good enough, right? Things counted as nothing at all and used them, used us to bring to nothing, pulled it down, the stuff that people think is important. Money, status, fame. What are the other things people think are important? What's the American dream? Big house with a picket fence, all that kind of stuff. The Bible is saying God will use people like us to show people all that stuff is temporary. All that stuff's gonna fade. What's seen is temporary. What's unseen is eternal. Do you know Jesus? God will use some people like me and you that came up on some hard times, that know what hard times are like. And when these so-called rich people, these so-called wise people, these so-called powerful people lose their jobs, lose their families, lose all the stuff that they were leaning on, all their idols that they were focusing on as their source of power, as their source of wisdom, as their source of strength, you can say, look here, brother. Look here, sister. I know what it's like to be without. And when I was at my lowest, do you know who helped me? It wasn't my money. It wasn't the people I thought were my friends. It wasn't all the status and fame. It was God. Everything people think is important, God uses people like us to bring that joint down, show people that it ain't nothing. You leaning on money, you leaning on fame, you leaning on friends, you leaning on people. All that stuff is going to fade and it's temporary. But if you lean on the one true rock, his name is Jesus, you will have everlasting life. You'll be on a firm foundation that will not fall. Next verse. Let's go to verse 29. As a result, no one can ever boast in the presence of God. Why, y'all? Keep going, keep going. Verse 30, God has united you with Christ Jesus. For our benefit, God made him to be wisdom itself. Yo, we cannot boast in God's presence. That's why God uses foolish people like us, because we're not going to try to take the credit. We know it's God. Listen, man, listen. For me to be pastor in this beautiful, awesome church, I'm humbled and honored every day. It's foolish. It doesn't make sense. Sometimes I get asked to go speak at conferences and people say, oh, well, you must have this degree. Or, oh, you must have that. Or you must have this or that. Dog, all I got is God. And when God speaks, I obey him as best I can, and I move. God told me to leave Zion Church, to leave the mega church environment I was in. I was a youth pastor of the largest youth ministry in North America, 4,000 people every Friday, and I was miserable because God was calling me to Northeast DC. And I left that with my pastor's blessing. Shout out to Keith Battle. Left with his blessing and came to the city, and God opened up doors for me to find a house in this city. For me to find people that thought like me, and we started developing disciples and doing outreaches, and 6.5 years later, we're still here. I didn't do that. Some people say, oh, Pastor Devin, tell me your blueprint.
I don't have one. A couple people said, Devin, you should write a book on how to be an urban church planter. It ain't got to be a book. It can be on a scrap sheet of paper. Pray, listen, obey. You can't manufacture your own miracles. Whatever God has for you to do in his foolish plan, you will do. Focus point. If you don't remember anything else this morning, I want you to remember this. God's plan is to use foolish people like me to help the intelligent and the ignorant understand his majesty. Let's prepare to close out. Whew. Loaded, loaded, loaded today. Loaded, loaded. Verse 31. Let's read that last verse again before we close. Therefore, as the scriptures say, if you want to boast, boast only about the Lord. Sometimes I'm I would get invited to these conferences before COVID and I would speak, and you know, some pastors get together and say, hey man, how many people you running? I don't run people. What are you talking about? I'm not a track coach. How many sheep you got? What are you talking about? I'm not a farmer. Oh, you know what I mean. No, I don't. How many people you got coming to your church? I don't know. You don't know? No, I don't. Because I don't have a church. So I don't even know what you're talking about. Oh, you're being so humble. Thanks. You should try it sometime. Because see, if I say that, then that's not being humble. Right? If you want to boast, boast only about the Lord, about his goodness, about his faithfulness, about the fact that he's kept your mind, about the fact that you're still alive in a pandemic, about the fact that you have a means to even be with us right now through this technology, the fact that you still have income coming in, the fact that you still have food. It may not be the food you want, but you got food, you got clothes, you got shoes. You have the activity of your limbs. That's what I'm going to boast in. That's what we got to boast in. Guess why, y'all? Because that's how God continues to use people like us. When we get to that place where we could start patting ourselves on our own backs, giving yourself all the credit and the kudos. Yeah, you know, I am a pretty dope pastor, ain't I? Pastor Turner, you know. When you start boasting in yourself, that's when God stops using you. Because now you're trying to use him. Don't miss that. Some of these preachers and ministers and people that have parachurch ministries all around the world, they started out on the right way. They started out humble, understanding that they're part of God's foolish plan. And the world views them as foolish. But when they started getting status and fame and attention, instead of viewing themselves as being used by God, they said, I'm going to use God for my own personal gain. I say, Pastor Devin, I want to avoid doing that. Pastor Devin, I hear what you're saying about me being a part of God's foolish plan. How do I take this message one step further in my spiritual journey? What's my next step? Here's our next step. And we close out with this. Identify who or what you need to surrender to God so that he can use you more effectively in his plan for your life. For some of us, there's a blocking as God is reaching to place us in his plan. But as God is reaching, there's something going blocking. God's reaching into your life and there's something blocking. Could be a person. Could be a mindset that you have. Could be some material possession that you have your eye on or that you're focused on. Whatever that idol is, surrender it to the Lord. Some of us have been saying, you know, I want to be used by you, Lord. I want to be used by you, Lord. Lord, use me. Lord, use me. And God is saying, I'm trying, but you keep blocking. I'm reaching out to you to have you be in my plan. But the problem is you have your own plan. See, we say, God, use me, Lord, use me, Lord, use me. I want to be a vessel for you, O Lord. And we tell God this in songs. But when it comes to living it out and God's reaching to put us in his plan, we keep blocking because we have our own plan. Surrender. Surrender to God, that person or that thing, so that he can use you more effectively in his plan for your life. Let's pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ, Lord, we come before you right now, and we ask that you would help us to surrender. Surrender our wants, surrender our desires, surrender our plans for your plans. Lord God, help us, Lord, to stop trying to be so strong-willed in what we think is best. And help us, Lord, to lean and listen more on what you tell us is blessed. And God, we pray that we'll be a part of that so-called foolish plan to help other people understand your majesty. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, if you're with us this morning and you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, the bad news is that we all were born in sin and that we all deserve judgment, which is eternal damnation in hell when we die. You say, well, Pastor Devin, why would you say I deserve to go to hell when I die? The Bible gave us 10 commandments, and the Bible says that if we break one of those commandments, we're guilty of sin, and anyone who sins must perish. If we've ever lied, if we've ever talked back to our parents, if we ever had a sexual thought or a sexual act with someone we're not married to, if we ever took something that didn't belong to us, we're guilty of breaking God's commandments. That's just 4 of the 10 commandments, but I'm running out of time, and so are you if you're not saved. So if you never asked Jesus Christ to be your Lord and Savior, today's a great day of salvation. The bad news is we all were born in sin and we all deserve that judgment, including me. But the good news is about 2,020 years ago, God sent his son Jesus Christ to die on the cross for your sins and for my sins. And the Bible says that if you put your hope and trust in Jesus, you will not perish, but you will have everlasting life. If you want to make that decision today to make Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior, pray this prayer with me now. Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ, I pray for my friends that are with me through the screen right now. I pray for everyone who needs to make a decision. I pray that they would do what Romans chapter 10, verses 9 through 10 tells them to do. I pray that they will confess with their mouths that Jesus Christ is the Lord of their lives. And I pray that they will believe in their hearts that you, God, raised Jesus from the dead and that they would be saved. We pray this prayer in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Amen. If you pray that prayer, I want you to click on the link in the chat, revolutiondc.org/decision. There, I want you to fill out that form, and I want you to press the button at the end of that form, and one of our online ministers will reach out to you within one day so that we can help you grow in your spiritual journey. If you made that decision today, I want to let you know it's the best decision of your life. God bless you. We're excited for you, and we want to help you grow in your spiritual journey. So please make sure you fill out the form and submit it today. At this time, we're going to prepare our hearts and our minds to give unto the Lord. And if you'd like to give an offering tithe to the church, you can click the link in the chat, revolutiondc.org/give. There you can put in your financial information safely and securely. All the proceeds that we collect will go towards helping to reach lost people, to help develop disciples, to help meet physical and spiritual needs. Because of your generosity, we've been able to feed people all over the country, and we've been able to bless all across the seas. We just did an awesome thing in the Congo, raised over $3,000 in such a short time to dig a well in the Congo. We're continuing to help families here in the city and abroad with rent, with other bills, with groceries, putting some families in safe houses that have been victims of gun violence. We're doing such great work. We just did a homeless outreach this past Saturday. We did 2 homeless outreaches in the fall alone. And it's because of your generosity, we're able to reach and meet the needs of our community here in the city and abroad. So thank you so much. If you'd like to give by phone, you can text your amount to 855-927-3593. That's 855-927-3593. And if you have a smartphone, you can use the Give Plus app.
And you can search for Revolution Church in Washington, D.C., and our zip code is 20019. Let's take a moment to pray over the offering. Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ, we thank you for all the finances that are being collected. We pray that you will bless those that are giving and bless those that have a desire to give. We pray, O Lord God, that you would bless the leadership of the church to continue to use the finances wisely to continue to advance your kingdom, O Lord God. We pray this prayer in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Amen. Well, if you'd like to receive updates from the church, you can text this number here on the screen, 844-949-3006. That's 844-949-3006, and you can text the word revolution with no quotation marks. You'll get all the updates that we send out through text blasts. If you'd like to grow in your spiritual journey, we recommend that you join one of our community groups. The guys meet every first and third Tuesday, and the ladies meet every second and fourth Tuesday. The guys use Google Hangout. The ladies use Zoom. If you'd like to be a part of one of those discipleship experiences, you can email us at groups@revolutiondc.org. Well, that's all the time that we have for today. I'm so excited that you came and spent some time with us today. It's a blessing to see you all in the chat, and it's a blessing to serve as your pastor. Remember to lift up His Majesty this week, and I'll see you next week at 11 a.m. Take care and God bless.